All right, good afternoon. On behalf of the Center for Arab and Islamic Studies, we'd like to welcome you to our discussion on Syria. I'm sure everyone here reads the paper or looks at the internet every day and may be shocked, confused, concerned about the emerging or current civil war in Syria. It's very deadly, very violent. At least 100 people, around 100 people a day are being killed. Tens, if not hundreds of thousands of people, tens of thousands of people flee a month. Hundreds of thousands of people, Syrians, have left and are now living in, and we'll find out more about it, in Jordan, Turkey, and Lebanon. It's an intractable situation, it seems, and we'll find out more about it. We're very fortunate today to have two, we were going to have three, but we're going to have two, excellent speakers who are intimately involved in the area. Our first speaker, and I'm going to introduce them both, and then they're both going to come up. Our first lecturer is going to be Rami Khouri. Rami Khouri actually co-teaches a class here at Villanova with me, lucky me. We teach a class Monday evenings on the Arab Awakening. He will be speaking, I don't know if we have the venue yet, do we yet? Joyce, where are you? He will also be speaking October 1st, next Monday in the evening. It might be here, I'm not sure where, on the Arab Awakening or the Arab Spring, the impacts of it and hopefully charting out where it's going to go. Rami Khouri is, I think, an astute columnist and observer. Where is October 1st talk going to be held? Do we have a location? We don't have a location. In Driscoll Hall? Okay, it's going to be in Driscoll Hall, and we'll get you, anyone here, a lot of you are, some of you are my students, anyone just keep your eye up. It's going to be in Driscoll Hall at 6 o'clock?
6 o'clock.
I believe at the auditorium,
right? Room 132.
Okay, room 132, which is the auditorium. Rami Khouri is a very astute columnist. He publishes regular columns in the Lebanese Daily Star newspaper, which is the English-speaking or the English-written paper. And has published a lot. He recently was in the New York Times. In addition to that, he teaches at the American University of Beirut, which is, by any standard, the best university in the Middle East, the most well-known English university, English-speaking university, but probably the best university in the Middle East, or most highly regarded university in the Middle East. That's the best, whatever we put it, at least in my opinion. He teaches at the Issam Ferris Institute for Public Policy. Joining him will be Mark Schnellbaecher. Mark Schnellbaecher is another resource we have here at Villanova. He is doing his sabbatical here at the Peace and Justice Department. But when Mark isn't here, Mark lives in Beirut, Lebanon, and he is the director of the Catholic Relief Service Europe and Middle East Office, the regional director of CRS. Has been there in Lebanon for 8 years and has served 22 years at CRS, the Catholic Relief Service. He is here all fall, and he has numerous degrees from both Harvard Divinity School and the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard, and he did his undergraduate at Georgetown, which is, although Jesuit, is still a good university. Right? Not as good as the Augustinians, but. We were going to have Father Simon Faddoul, who was here last year. He's a real fascinating guy, but he called me this morning and he has to get over to the Bekaa Valley, which is in Lebanon, with an emergency because of the refugees. He's doing something, he didn't give me quite all the information, but he had to leave Beirut and go to the Bekaa Valley. And if any of you have been to the Bekaa Valley, they do not have Skype. I'm sure one group over there has Skype connections, but it's hard to get Skype connections with the United States from the Bekaa Valley. So with no further ado, Rami is going to start. I just mentioned that after you put food in his mouth. But Rami.
Here's the mic there.
Is this mic on? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can you turn the mic?
Mm-hmm.
It works? Okay. It works. Thank you very much for having me, for being here, for co-teaching this course for this semester. It was a great honor and a lot of fun to meet a lot of really fascinating, wonderful people at Villanova. I can't believe that as a Syracuse basketball graduate, I'm with Villanova and Georgetown. I mean, that's like painful, but it's overridden by these wonderful people. So I'm glad that I'm here. I want to talk about Syria. We'll talk about maybe 10, 15 minutes each, and then have an open discussion. Syria is the most important proxy war in the world since Vietnam and Afghanistan. It is the single most important proxy battle in the whole world. And it's important because it brings together two extraordinary dynamics. Syria brings together two extraordinary dynamics at one point. The first dynamic is that it has three levels of confrontation. You have the internal battle between the opposition and the regime, which is going on in many different forms. It has become a regional proxy battleground in which a group of countries and movements like Hezbollah and others and political forces around the region with Syrian government and Iran and others, a group of these forces are confronting another group of countries and movements which are more conservative and headed by Saudi Arabia. So I don't know, there's not an easy shorthand term to use for them because they're not all of the same group. So the Iran, Syria, Hezbollah, other, you know, they're sort of, you call them, some of them are Islamists, some of them are nationalists, some of them are leftists. I mean, they're just a hodgepodge of different groups that are not easily categorized under one umbrella. It used to be easier in the past. You could say the pro-Soviets or the pro-American or the conservatives and the liberals, but it's not like that anymore. It's much more complicated. So that's the second intense regional Cold War, in a way, that's fighting itself out in Syria. And the third level is the Russian-Chinese versus the American-led global confrontation, which is a kind of revived Cold War. Many of you are too young to remember the old Cold War between the Soviet Union and the United States, leading their respective camps. But this is something similar, but less intense. But it is a global confrontation, and it is also playing itself out inside Syria. So you've got these three levels of, not only are they intense confrontations, they're also seen by the players to be existential battles. In other words, one side is going to win and the other side is going to get wiped out and eradicated from history. This is not just, you know, you lose a battle and then you regroup and you come back and fight another day. This is existential. So if the government in Syria doesn't hold its own and gets overthrown, it's gone forever, the Ba'athist regime and the Assad family. And the same with the opposition. If they're beaten back, they're gone forever. And the same with the regional confrontation. The global confrontation is not quite so existential, but it has elements of huge consequences. And the reason that people like the Russians, for instance, are so hard on supporting the Syrian government and pushing back against the Americans and others is because they don't want the United States and its allies to decide which governments come and which governments go. And they don't want the Middle East to be dominated by an American-led group of countries that can call the shots. So they see this as really hugely important for them, for the Russians, as a defining moment when they can reassert their influence in this region and in the world. So that's one dynamic, these three levels of confrontations that are superimposed. And that explains the intensity, the savagery, the determination, the courage, all the different attributes of this very intense and conflict which has gone on now for about a year and 7 months, since March, late March 2010. The second big set of issues that defines this conflict and why it's so important. Have a seat. Joyce, have a seat. Yeah. This is going to go on for a while. The second big group of dynamics that makes it so intense is that the various confrontations in and about Syria capture almost every major confrontation that has gone on in this region for the last 50 years. In other words, the Arab-Israeli conflict is mirrored in the, it's not directly in there, but it's mirrored because the Syrians say, for instance, the government says, we're going to fight back this threat to remove us because we, the Syrian government, are leading the Arab resistance to Zionist colonialism, and et cetera, et cetera. They couch it in terms of the Syrians leading the Arab struggle against Israel or defending Arab rights against Israeli encroachment. So there's dimensions of the Arab-Israeli conflict. There are dimensions of the Iranian-Arab tensions. The Saudis make no bones about it. They say openly, and if you've heard Saudi officials speak on the record or off the record, they're a little bit more polite on the record, but it's clear to them, they say clearly, this is where we want to push back the Iranian regime for various reasons. They give different reasons, some of which I think make sense, some of which I think are vastly exaggerated. But the Saudis see Syria as the place where they will fight the Iranians. And by defeating the Syrian government, they can reduce Iranian influence in the region in various ways. So you have the Iranian-Arab struggle is mirrored in Syria. You have the corollary to that, which is what many people call the Sunni-Shiite confrontation, which I personally believe is vastly exaggerated. I don't think there is a real Sunni-Shiite serious war in the region. But many people do think that, and many scholars and many political analysts in this country and around the region think there is a real serious Sunni-Shiite problem. And whether there is or there isn't, the fighting in Syria has connotations of Sunni-Shiite tensions in various ways, because the Alawite regime, the Assad family Alawite regime, is seen to be an offshoot of Shiites, and also is very, the Alawites are sort of an offshoot of Shiites, and also the regime is very close to Iran and close to Hezbollah. So you have these linkages. It also has, the Syrian situation has echoes of a very long-running confrontation across the Arab world, which is between conservative monarchies and the other side, I don't know what the right adjective to use is, but republics of some sort. They used to be called progressive, they used to be called nationalist, they used to be called socialist. There's many terms that people use to speak about them. I'm supposed to be late for a class at the moment.
I know, I apologize.
Welcome.
Nice to see you.
The monarchies versus the republics, or the conservatives versus the liberals or nationalists, whatever. These adjectives don't apply anymore, but there are these two groups of countries, and they are represented in the conflict inside Syria. You also see a struggle which is not completely cleanly delineated, but you see echoes of it, which is Islamist nationalist versus secular nationalists. In other words, you have Islamist groups in Syria who are Muslim Brotherhood groups, some of the Salafi fundamental Sunni Muslim groups, the sprinkling of Al-Qaeda type terror groups that have now infiltrated into Syria by most of them by way of Iraq, where they were attracted by the presence of the American and British armies, by the way. So this question of spreading Qaeda-type Salafi terror groups around the region is very heavily linked to the consequences of the Anglo-American invasion in Iraq, which is a historical process which I think any honest political analyst or scholar needs to examine. So if people in the West are worried about these Salafi terrorist groups, they should have thought about that when people invaded Iraq and provided the greatest magnet and training ground for Salafi terrorists since the Soviets invaded Afghanistan. But there's sprinkling of these Salafi terrorist groups. And so you have these groups that are militants and resistance fighters, and you know, some of them good guys, some of them bad guys, but they all speak in the language of Islamism. And on the other side, you have people who are more secular. I don't mean the Saudis, because they're very Islamic in their own Wahhabi way, but many of the people fighting against the Islamists are secular, and they claim that, and they say, some people who are supporting the regime say, we have to keep this regime in place in Syria, because if the regime falls, the Islamists are going to take over, and we will all be like Iran, which I think is total nonsense myself, but this is an argument that people make. So there are dimensions of a secular religious confrontation of some sorts. So you get all of these six levels of confrontation coming together. So every major confrontation in the region for the last 50 or 60 years is echoed in the struggle in Syria. And that's why it is so intense, why people are so vicious, determined, courageous at one level. I'm speaking mostly about the rebels. The people have been going out on the streets and fighting the regime in Syria, or challenging the regime peacefully for the most part, for the last year and 7 months. And knowing that they're going to get bombed by airplanes and helicopters and artillery, but they still go out. There's this fierce determination by so many ordinary Syrians to live in a free and normal society. And this raises one other question, which I think we have to look at in historical terms as well somehow. Syria is like North Korea in a way, sort of the last Stalinist state. It's the last centrally controlled, militarily based, hard security state. And we see by the behavior of the government now, they're shelling bakeries and they're shelling hospitals. I mean, the brutality of what the government is doing is extremely vicious. And they defend it. They say that they're facing a foreign conspiracy, etc., etc. But virtually the whole world is now against the Syrian government. There's very few people who support it. The majority of Syrian people seem to want this government to go. And if this government does get changed and is brought down, it'll be a historic marker, I think, showing that these hard police states and security states can be brought down by their own people. There is foreign support for the rebels, mostly light arms, money, humanitarian aid, equipment, logistical stuff from the Western countries, from Arab countries, Saudis, Qataris, many different people are helping the rebel. But at another level, this is a historic marker, because the fall of the Soviet Union was not the end of the authoritarian modern security state, but breaking Syria probably would be, I think. And then, you know, North Korea would be the last one. Major calculations. People like Myanmar, they're evolving. There's very few hard security states left, and Syria is one of them. And my guess is that the regime will be overthrown in the next months. How many months? One, three, seven, we don't know. But my guess is that they will, because they're essentially losing every pillar of their incumbency, their support, and their legitimacy. They're losing control of huge amounts of territory now. the central government essentially doesn't function as a central government anymore. It pays about 200,000 to 300,000 of its soldiers and employees. It doesn't control territory all over Syria anymore. Most of the north and the east is out of the government's control. There's hundreds and hundreds of small resistance groups operating all over the country, mostly locally organized. And the economy has almost completely collapsed. And the government is providing some subsidized food and medical care and stuff like that to a small number of people around the country who are directly part of its Ba'ath Party system or its employees or civil service or the armed forces. It's probably serving about maybe 3 million, 4 million people out of the 20, 21 million Syrians. The vast majority of Syrians are living in a kind of free-for-all situation. It's quite chaotic all over the country. Order is being maintained by local groups around the country who have taken control. And there's a running battle with the government essentially only now being able to use air power. They can't even send out troops in large numbers anymore as they used to because communication lines are cut and they're attacked. If they send out a group of ground troops, they're attacked and ambushed all along the way. So all they can do is fire from the air. And as we know from many historical situations, including the U.S. and Vietnam, the Russians and Afghanistan, you can't win an air battle against a determined nationalist uprising. And the question then becomes, I'll finish with this, the question then becomes, when the regime falls, what happens next? My guess is that there will not be a complete disintegration of Syria as some people fear, that Syria will not collapse into a small series of ethnic states, to have an Alawite state and a Christian state and a Druze state and a Kurdish state. I don't think that'll happen. I think the sense of Syrian national identity is strong. It's very real. But the Syrians have never been allowed to really define their nationalism. The people of Syria have never been able to define their nationalism. And I think this is something that they will relish when the opportunity comes after the regime is overthrown, that the Syrian people to come together and figure out a transitional mechanism that allows them not just to run the government efficiently and fairly, but to define themselves as a country, their values, their principles, their institutions, their priorities, what's the secular part, what's the religious part, what's the role of the central government, what's the role of the provinces, what's the role of the military institutions, what's the role of the civilian institutions. These fundamental issues of self-determination will provide an opportunity for Syrians, I think, to get together and really shape their country as they've never had a chance to do before. The people who have the power in Syria are the people on the ground leading the resistance against the government. And there's hundreds, some people say 2,000 to 3,000 of these groups. I think now they're starting to come into coalesce into smaller and smaller groups where they coordinate. But there's often at the village level, the neighborhood level, even the street level, the local people who know everybody in the neighborhood and are trusted lead this fight against the government and lead the need in the meantime to provide basic services for their community, security, food, water, in some cases, justice. If there's a crime and the government's not there, they figure out how do you dispense fair justice. Some do it with tribal values, some do it with modern law, some do it with Islamic values, and everybody chooses their own. But it's these groups on the ground, the local coordinating committees, the local resistance committees, they have many different names. Some of them are Islamists, some are nationalists, some are tribal, some are family-based, some are secular. There's a whole hodgepodge of these. They're starting to come together in sort of conglomerates of resistance forces in Aleppo. They're based on cities and regions, so Dera and Aleppo and Hama and Homs, Deir ez-Zor. And these will be the people who will lead the transition because they are already in power. So the question of who's going to take over in Syria has already been answered. People in this country or in Europe who ask, well, who's going to take over? You're asking the question of a year ago. They've already we know who's going to take over. It's these people on the ground, because they led resistance. And just as in the United States, if you go back to your revolutionary period, the people who led the fight against the British and won are the people who went to Philadelphia and Boston and Washington and created the new country. It's the people on the ground with the military power, but more importantly, with the legitimacy that is vested in them by the trust that is given to them by their own people. And that critical link of legitimacy and trust from your own people is the link to watch out for. So some guy sitting in Washington or in London or in Bonn or in Dubai who comes and gives a grandiose plan about how to remake Syria, he or she is not going to get much attention. The real power is with these people. They're already on the ground, and they know who they are. They don't give interviews on CNN, so they're not known to the world very much, but the Syrians know who they are, and they're starting to come together in these bigger and bigger groups. And I would imagine in the next month or two at the most, we will see a government in exile, a transitional government in exile that will not actually be in exile, will be based on the agreement of these groups in Syria, but will have a representative in Istanbul or in Bonn or somewhere abroad to provide a mechanism for the world to interact with. So that's the next thing to watch for. The Syrian Free Syrian Army said that 2 days ago they actually moved their headquarters into northern Syria. There's now parts of northern Syria that are completely under the rebel control, like Benghazi was in Libya. So I think we're entering a new stage of this contest. So let me stop there and turn it over.
Okay, we'll hold the questions until after Mark, please. Mark?
I'd like to just talk about one particular. I want to speak about one slice of the subjects that Rami was speaking about, and that is the humanitarian situation that's been with us for a while now, but is becoming much more acute since June or July of this year, when the fighting increased in ferocity. The government increased dramatically its use of air power against both the fighters and the civilian population. I think first, though, I want to give you a little bit of demographic background of the context of Syria. It's got a population of about 22 million people. 90% or so are Arab, and 10% are Kurd. The Kurd are mostly in the north of the country. It's estimated that about 71% of the population is Sunni, 11% Alawite, which is an offshoot of Shia Islam, which is the religion of the ruling family, the Assads, and many of the people who are in their circle. It's 3% Druze, which is a rather esoteric religion that combines elements of Islam and Christianity and other philosophies and theologies. They're located in Syria and in Lebanon and in Israel. It's about 10% Christian. So that's sort of the religious and demographic mosaic. It's very complicated religiously. This is why those who portray the conflict in Syria as a sectarian war or fear that it would become one, this is why people are concerned, because it has this kind of a makeup. There's not any real, these different religious groups are not really occupying particular parts of the country. Everything is all mixed up. And this is why those who fear this becoming a sectarian war often say this will, if it becomes a sectarian war, it will be worse than Iraq, because you've got more actors, less delineated geographically from where they sit. The first important thing to recognize when looking at the humanitarian context of the Syrian situation, by which I mean both inside Syria and in the surrounding countries, is that on top of the Syrian displaced and Syrian refugees who are now being created by this conflict, already since 1948, these countries, with the exception of Turkey, have been hosting Palestinian refugees now into the third and fourth generation. So there's a long history of experience with refugees, not always pleasant. For the last decade, since the American invasion of Iraq, there's also been more than a million Iraqi refugees in these countries. So for a decade or more, these countries have been hosting Iraqi refugees, and their experience with the Palestinian refugees has led them to certain actions and conclusions and legal treatment of Iraqi and now Syrian refugees, which is not really to the benefit of these refugees. For example, none of these countries has signed the UN protocols on the treatment of refugees. Initially, they came out in the early 50s. Initially, these countries which hosted Palestinians didn't sign these treaties as a political point. They didn't recognize these people as refugees because they wanted to support their ability to go back to their homeland in what is now Israel. That has sort of hardened their positions as to any new refugees. In fact, in these countries, in Jordan, in Lebanon, in Iraq, these people are not called refugees, they're called guests, which on the one hand is very nice in Arabic hospitality and all that. The problem with being a guest is your host can always ask you to leave. And this is what makes it a tenuous legal status for refugees. There are approximately 300,000 Iraqi or Syrian refugees now outside of the country. As of last week, the numbers are as follows. There are 85,000 in Turkey, 76,000 in Lebanon, 94,000 in Jordan, and 30,000 in Iraq. So even though there's 600,000 or so Iraqi refugees still in Syria, there's now 30,000 or so Syrian refugees in Iraq. In addition to this, there's about 1.2 million Syrians who are displaced within Syria. Now, the Syrian government will not call these people displaced. They're referred to as people who have left their homes. There's a certain denial of reality going on there in terms of what the regime is willing to regard the situation of its citizens. Of that 1.2 million, an estimated half are kids under 15 years old. So there's a substantial portion of the Syrian population, about 7 or 8%, which are on the move somewhere, either within the country or outside of their country. And yet, despite this humanitarian situation, which is, I wouldn't yet describe it as a crisis, although I think it's rapidly approaching that point, the international response has been tepid at best, which is, I'd like to talk a little bit, try to understand with you why this has been the case. Because every day now for certainly the last 6 months, every other day for the last 12 months, and once a week for the last 18 months, we've been seeing the Syrian war on the news, on the internet. It's becoming increasingly gruesome to watch. It's becoming, as Rami said, increasingly vicious. Both sides, certainly the government has the advantage with its air power and whatnot, but no longer are Syrian army or these many militia groups, no longer can they claim virginal innocence in terms of their practices. There have been enough verified cases of torture and other battlefield practices that call their ethics into question. I think there's a couple of reasons why the response, both internationally and regionally, has been as tepid as it is. First of all, for the first year, this was a low-grade conflict. Until I would say this spring, late spring, it was low-grade, sporadic fighting inside the country. Very few people had left. Many of us on the outside in these surrounding countries were wondering, why haven't there been more refugees? Why is it only in the tens of thousands, which is where it was until May this year. It's now spiked dramatically. 25 times, 20 or 25 times from that, but it was a very slow burn sort of humanitarian development of a humanitarian emergency that needed external response. The second was sort of the denial on the part of these surrounding countries, for reasons which I just discussed, as to accept these people and to ask for help. Many of the countries thought it was only going to be a temporary problem. They didn't want to formalize it by asking the international community for assistance. A third reason is, and this is a little bit complicated, but unfortunately, the plan, the six-point plan put together by Kofi Annan, who was the, until the end of last month, was the UN and Arab League representative or interlocutor between the rebels and the regime, he included in his plan humanitarian access. And what this, what he did basically by including it as one of the six levers to try to come to a resolution of the conflict, he basically tied political reconciliation and humanitarian access quite tightly together, so that funding for humanitarian action on the part of other governments, like our government, the European Union, and whatnot, basically became contingent upon the prospects for political resolution. So as those prospects faded further and further into the horizon, to the point that Kofi Annan quit his job, so this sort of let the donor governments off the hook in providing assistance. The assistance which has been requested has been doubled in the last 3 months by the United Nations. They had their appeals had been at about $300 million for both inside Syria and for the surrounding, for refugees in the surrounding countries. That has recently been doubled to $600 million, which essentially gives you a pretty good idea of the rapid escalation of the humanitarian emergency. Less than 40% of that has been contributed. So the UN is having great difficulties, as are some of these host governments, in responding to this problem. However, I personally, from what I've seen in Lebanon and Jordan, and have heard about in Syria, I'm not at all convinced that even if $600 million materialized tomorrow, that it could be well spent in the near term to respond to what are certainly growing humanitarian needs. And the reason for that is the greatest amount of the suffering that's being caused by this conflict is undoubtedly inside Syria, and the access there is extremely, extremely difficult. I haven't been to Syria in over a year because they won't give us visas. That is the case for most humanitarian agencies. A deal was cut by the UN and the Assad regime back in June, which would allow for humanitarian action, but placed extremely unusual and strict limitations on just how that humanitarian action can be delivered. Only 7 international organizations like Catholic Relief Services or Save the Children or Oxfam are allowed to operate in the country. None of those 3 that I mentioned are among the 7. Furthermore, the humanitarian aid operation inside Syria is monopolized by the Syrian Arab Red Crescent, which is a quasi-governmental organization, essentially an organ of the regime, and they have the first and last say in where assistance will be given, to whom it will be given, by whom it will be given, which brings us to a situation that's not unlike that in Darfur, where you have a regime that at once is battling its own people, and at the same time dictating what humanitarian aid can be given to them by controlling basically the actions of the international community, whether it's the United Nations or the ICRC, the International Committee for the Red Cross, or the international non-governmental organizations that seek to provide assistance. So this is it's a very, both an unusual situation, an unfortunately unusual situation, but also one that is and one that is making it very, very difficult for organizations to provide assistance to those who need it most. That's not to say people living in these tent camps in Turkey or in the new ones that are being built in Jordan are not in need of assistance. They are, but they can be accessed very easily to these governments are, particularly Jordan, is asking for international assistance and is making it quite easy to provide it. The story's a little bit different in Turkey. They are very concerned about the access of foreigners to these people. I think this has political reasons because a lot of the military planning and backstaging of military operations inside Syria occurs from these camps in Turkey, and so the Turks don't want too many people mucking around inside them. But nonetheless, the greatest number of people who need assistance are in a place where very few people can get to them. I think this speaks to the determination in that, despite the fact of their quickly deteriorating living conditions, so few Syrians have left the country. Even though they know if they want assistance, they have to leave. Most people haven't. 300,000 is a lot of refugees, but it's not a lot when you compare it out of the population. 22 million, more and more of whom are becoming, if not directly involved in this conflict, certainly directly affected by it. I think this speaks to the determination of Syrians to bring about to be willing to bear pretty heavy costs to bring about a change in this regime. The prospects, I don't see anything good happening on the humanitarian front until the regime falls, or until large parts of the regime falls, because they do still control all the borders. They still do control access to the country. And as long as that remains the case, there'll continue to be this imbalance of assistance going to a relatively small group of refugees who are outside the country, as opposed to allowing humanitarian assistance to reach those inside the country who need it most. So I really don't see any improvement of that situation until significant institutions or parts of the regime begin to collapse and things open up a little bit. I wish I could say something more positive about this situation, but I can't. This, I think, is the reason why there has not been greater humanitarian action on the part of governments or private individuals or organizations like my own is this access issue. We get the money, great, but what are we going to do with it inside the country? And the answer right now is wait.
All right. Just so people know, we have been talking about doing a fundraiser for the refugees, and we're figuring it out still. So we will talk, we'll let people know what happens and when it happens. We have time, a nice period of time for questions, and we'll start with students. So, sorry, but we're going to have students first. So any students, please.
Thank you both for coming. I have a question that might bounce between the two of you.
Can you speak up a little bit?
Yeah, sorry. A bit soft-spoken. I know this is about Syria, so I'm sorry to bring up Lebanon, but Syria being sort of a proxy state, as you were saying, or a proxy war between a lot of these powers, and then Lebanon also being even more almost a proxy sort of war involving Syria as well and a lot of other regional power. I was in Lebanon 2 summers ago, and I was impressed that the nature of the divisions that were in Lebanon during the civil war have changed somewhat. The unity between the Shia and the Palestinians, for instance, has changed. And there are long-term Israeli interests in the south, particularly in the Litani River and in southern Lebanon. What do you think if Syria, if the regime were to fall in Syria, and particularly Hezbollah, the line of funding were to be cut, what would the ramifications be for Lebanon? And how would that, if there was civil conflict, is there any idea how it would take place? What is the nation?
Well, you have civil, you have sectarian-based conflict going on to a very limited degree in Syria now. The government seems to be trying to provoke it in some ways. The Schnellbaecher, these militias that are mostly Alawite people who are going around and acting as the stormtroopers for the regime, and they've been attacking mostly Sunni villages around the Alawite heartland. And there is a sense that some Christians are worried and moving to the Tartus area, and that some Sunnis are leaving, going away from Alawite areas, and some Alawites are leaving mixed areas. There's reports of some of that going on. So I think there are early signs of sectarian tensions which have been deliberately provoked, I believe, and many other people believe, deliberately provoked by the regime. They want to say that, look, if this regime falls, there's going to be civil war on sectarian basis, and therefore they're, I think, trying to instigate that. The vast majority of Syrians have not gotten involved in sectarian warfare. And the interesting thing is that the potential spillover into Lebanon that has happened has been very limited, and mostly it's Alawites and Sunnis in Tripoli in the north of Lebanon. You're right that the nature of sectarian solidarity, politics, and confrontation in Lebanon, inside Lebanon, has evolved over the years. The scary thing in Lebanon, what frightens most Lebanese, is that the real danger in Lebanon is a Sunni-Shiite confrontation. In the Civil War, it was more like Christian-Muslim, and the Muslim was sort of every poor Muslim. That's evolved, that's changed. The fact that you have a Shiite Hezbollah, the biggest Shiite group, allied with the biggest Christian leader, which is Michel Aoun, who somebody tried to assassinate the other day. That shows you the complicated situation, that it's not, again, clean cut. So you have the biggest Christian group allied with the biggest Shiite group. But my sense is, I'm not Lebanese, I'm Palestinian Jordanian myself, so I have a little bit of a, I think, maybe objective, maybe impartial view, looking at Lebanon not as a Lebanese and having great respect for the country and admiration for it. I believe the Lebanese are not silly or stupid or suicidal enough to allow themselves to be provoked into a civil war from external intervention. They've had their civil war. It didn't solve anything. They're all aware of that. Everybody suffered. They're still feeling the consequences of it. And they're not going to do it again, even if somebody tries to provoke them. And therefore, I believe that the spillover from Syria has already happened. And we've seen it at a very low intensity level, localized, very localized incidents here and there, mostly in the Tripoli area. I doubt it's going to get much worse than that, but it'll probably stay like this, that you'll have, and somebody will try to assassinate somebody, somebody will set off a bomb. Unfortunately, that's the kind of routine. The good news in Lebanon is that the central government, in the last, I would say, year, has become much more active and dynamic and proactive in putting out these little fires when they emerge, and to the point where they send the armed forces, the central army, goes into places like Tripoli to separate the fighters. The other day there was a group of Shiites in South Beirut who kidnapped some Syrians and kidnapped a Turkish fellow in return, because some of their people, Shiites, were kidnapped by the Free Syrian Army in Syria. They did it tit for tat. But the Lebanese government finally went in and arrested these guys and issued warrants for them in southern Beirut. So there are clear signs of a more assertive, confident, and capable Lebanese central government. It has its limits. They're not going to go in there and fight Hezbollah. They're not going to. But the Hezbollah is the only major armed group in Lebanon, really. Some of the Christian groups probably have small militias, but nobody has any major capabilities other than Hezbollah. But there are signs that the Lebanese government is being much more assertive, and that puts out also little fires when they start. When somebody goes and tries to block the airport road by burning tires in the street, the army goes in very quickly and cleans it up. So I think that the spillover from Syria is going to be will be very limited. I don't think you're going to get a full-fledged civil war in Syria, but the sectarian tensions that have emerged in Syria are serious, and they could get worse. If this goes on for another year or two, it could become catastrophic. But I don't think that's going to happen. I think the overthrow of the government is going to provide such a welcome opportunity for the Syrians to actually define themselves as a civil, democratic, pluralistic state, that they'll probably be so enthused with that that they'll... but they've got to find a transitional justice mechanism. They've got to... the people who treated them so brutally for so many decades have to be somehow brought to justice. And then I think the implications for Lebanon can only be positive in the long run. To have a democratic Syria can only be good for Lebanon. It does create problems for Hezbollah, and that's a question that nobody can answer. What will Hezbollah do if the Syrian regime falls? And the Hezbollah is linked to Iran strategically. Without that conduit through Syria, they have to find other ways to be in touch. And so it raises important strategic and political existential issues for Hezbollah. And Hezbollah is a very smart, methodical group. They don't sit there and watch this stuff on Jazeera and say, well, we'll see what happens. They're planning now with scenarios. So they will almost certainly have no option but to fully integrate into the Lebanese political and defense system more than they are now, while trying to maintain themselves as the great resistance group fighting Israel. How they square those two things is it's hard to see, but they'll have to figure it out.
Questions?
Just to reiterate, thanks for speaking today. But what I was curious about is you said that during the first year it was a low-grade conflict, and then this spring that the fighting kind of picked up. So I was just wondering if you could elaborate on what actually changed and how the rebels became, how it turned into more of a civil war than much more peaceful protests.
I think there's several reasons for both internal and say sort of external influences that ramped it up or caused it to be ramped up or allowed it to ramp up. One, after a year of civil protests, largely peaceful protests, and an increasingly harsh response and harshly inappropriate response by the government, I think more and more people sort of reached a critical you got to a critical mass where enough of people were saying it's not working. Just going out onto the streets and getting hauled in and having our kids tortured, it's not getting us anywhere. The government's not coming out with any plausible or meaningful proposals for reform. Instead, it's upping its military response to us. So I think there was the movement towards a critical mass of sentiment or of analysis on the part of ordinary Syrians about what was going to move this thing forward. Secondly, I think related to that is you did have the government reacting basically in the only way that it knew how, going back to the Father's Day when Hafez Assad bombed the hell out of Hama and killed 20 to 30,000 people in 1982. So what we're seeing today is sort of from the playbook, much more geographically spread, but the basic playbook that this regime has become familiar with and has used before. Thirdly, in the spring is when there was a concerted effort on the part of some outsiders to begin supporting, in a methodical fashion, the resistance. So the setting up in Turkey of sort of an operations room, which was supplied by Saudi and Qatar, with the involvement, surely, of the CIA for some advice, a much more robust French, at least rhetorical, French activity on this front. So the funding of salaries for FSA fighters by some of the Gulf states. So the means to react in a more robust and unfortunately less peaceful manner became available about 6 months ago or so, which then began a cycle. It sort of reinforced the paranoia and the rhetoric of the regime, which was saying these are just a bunch of terrorists who are entirely outside, sort of adding insult to what they'd already done to the Syrian people, basically portraying them as dupes of outsiders, battling the regime at the behest of outsiders, and therefore the regime increasing the violence of the reaction, thereby more and more people joining this growing critical mass and saying, although we wish we could. could do this peacefully, it's clear we can. So that's my own short interpretation of how we got to where we are.
I just add one more thing, which is about a month after the Kofi Annan effort started, people realized it wasn't going anywhere. And sometime in the spring, the people leading the fighting, the resistance inside Syria, essentially gave up on the international community and realized there was going to be no significant either military aid or diplomatic solution from the international community, and decided they have to just rely on themselves. And this was very clearly transmitted by people inside Syria. We heard this from them all the time, that sometime around, they said that basically it's us and God. We have to do this. And that's when the fighting picked up with along with the other reasons that you just heard.
And we can open it up for anybody now who has a question.
In addition to the political interests, are there any economic interests at stake in Syria that these players are engaging?
There's a big debate about that. I mean, Syria in itself, the question is about economic interests. Are there economic interests that people have? If you're talking presumably about the external powers.
Right.
You know, there's no single overwhelming economic resource that people are fighting for, like oil or minerals or anything. Syria has dwindling, its oil production is going down. It has some other minerals, phosphates and things like that, but there's no single economic benefit that it has. I think it's more sort of geostrategic, political. The Russians are terrified of any kind of victorious movement that has Islamic elements in it because of their own Islamist problems in Chechnya and Georgia and places like that, and in the Caucasus, the Caucasus area. And they're absolutely terrified of these rebels overthrowing the Syrian government, because they would then see it as a precedent for people inside Russia. Chinese possibly have a similar fear about the Muslims and some of the Muslims in the western part of China, but less so. That the Russians have an active war, have had a war going on with some Islamist movements. So it's really more political than resources. The Chinese, of course, are interested in oil, access to oil, but Syria is a transit route for that more than a direct choice of oil.
So what happens when, you know, we mentioned how it's pretty much inevitable that the government will fall, and we've been talking about all these external actors. So what happens when it does fall to all these confrontations and these interests? Do you think it's going to be sort of a wait and see what the Syrian people produce as far as government goes, or will everyone sort of be jockeying for position within Syria itself? How do you think that the external confrontations will play out?
With this proliferation of militias, I think there's reason to have growing concern that we may enter a period, at least in part of the countries, of warlordism. These militias could easily turn into sort of warlord types and controlling different areas while the bigger battle for the future, political battle for the future of Syria is fought amongst them. Don't forget those who claim leadership of this are on the outside. Sort of the known quantities of the Syrian dissent community or opposition community for the last 20 years, almost all are on the outside. They have, if any, basically no credibility left inside Syria, because they've been gone, because they're on the outside, because the dying is occurring inside Syria. They have very little influence or credibility inside the country. There is not yet any sort of ruling or commander's forum or anything like that among these different people. There is sort of at the local level, there is some sort of tactical coordination going on, but there's nothing ready to step in. So that the day the regime falls or the day after. So that's, to my mind, leads to room for a certain amount of infighting and skirmishing among the people, increasingly well-armed people, who who are leading these different militia groups, who have very different visions for the future of Syria, from the Salafis to the Brotherhood to sort of born-again Baathists and secular Syrians. So I don't think that it will have to be negotiated, but what happens, how do you calm it down enough so that negotiation can occur when you have an increasing number of these armed groups running around the country? That's going to be the trick, is how to settle them down so that the political discussion can occur and all voices in Syria can be heard in it. Because that's the big concern right now among some of these minorities, is they will not have a voice in the construction of the future of Syria, whether constitutionally or politically. Certainly the fear of the Alawis, in addition to their fears of revenge, but it's also a very big fear among Christians and among the Druze. And obviously everybody wants to have their say, but if you don't have a militia, will you have a say? That's one of the big questions right now.
One of the things that's special about Syria compared to the three other countries we've seen in North Africa that got rid of their leaders and are going through a transition, Libya, Tunisia, and Egypt, there's two things that are essentially different. One is that the French colonial experience in the Levant, the British and the French colonial experience, has left us this kind of situation. So I'm not saying all the blame is on the colonialist powers, but there's a lot of historical legacy that is coming back to haunt this region, in the sense that these countries were never shaped, validated, or configured by their own people. And therefore, you have this situation where you have a range of different sectarian and ethnic and national groups who are competing. The second thing about this is that the pluralistic nature of Syria compared to, say, Egypt, Tunisia, or Libya, which are much more mono group. You have a big Christian minority in Egypt, a small Jewish minority in Tunisia. Libya is mostly Arab and some Berber. You don't have the mosaic of ethnicities that you have in Syria. The second thing is the ruling family in Syria for 42 years has been very much configured on a sectarian basis, that Alawites have been dominant in the security services, the bureaucracy, and all other money-making private institutions and other things. Those two things together make Syria's transition much more complicated than the three countries of North Africa. But having said that, I would also add that when you get a process of transformation started to create a new legitimate government system that does bring into play all of the different political and ethnic groups in the country, they will negotiate some kind of power-sharing mechanism that is fair and acceptable to them all, ideally. That's how we hope it'll work. The best example we have, I think, is from Libya right now, because Libya is probably the closest to Syria in terms of the tribal groups, that each one has many militia groups, and they're negotiating how to share power in a constitutional system with an elected parliament and an elected president, etc., etc. In Egypt and Tunisia, they're going through a very dramatic exercise. I'll talk about this in my public lecture soon here, about what is it that we can learn from the last year and 9 months, that what have we actually achieved in these Arab uprisings, and what is there still to be done. But one of the great achievements has been a heroic, epic, and very moving process of constitutionalism in Tunisia and Egypt, especially. And they're sitting there negotiating publicly in the media, in political groups, the role of women, the role of minorities, the role of religion. It's fascinating to see it happen peacefully, democratically, constitutionally, and pluralistically. It hasn't come to conclusions yet. But Tunisia and Egypt, they're sitting there every day working out these issues. What is the role of Islam and the constitution? Is power vested in the people, or is power vested in God? And if God is the power, how do human beings understand the divine mandate and translate it into traffic laws? How do you do that? They're actually going through this and trying to figure it out. And this is one of the great exciting things about this transitional process. Hopefully something like that will happen in Syria. It'll be probably more complicated because of the different ethnic groups and the understandable fear that when the state collapses, you need to turn to something or somebody to protect you and to give you a voice and to provide you with services. And if the state isn't there to do that anymore, which it isn't in Syria, you're going to get that mostly from your ethnic or sectarian or tribal group. There's no political party. So there will be a more complicated transitional period, sure. But I think there's a lot of hopeful signs that we can see from North Africa that should make us less fearful, which is why I'm not so fearful about an all-out sectarian civil war.
I'm going to...
Why is there not mass starvation? I can't imagine ordinary agricultural production, ordinary agricultural distribution. I can't imagine ordinary salaries, the electricity to run plants being generated widely. Why is there not mass starvation?
Oh, it's a good question. I think the one that we're going to continue to wonder about. The Food and Agriculture Organization of the UN did a rapid assessment of the agricultural situation in Syria in the springtime, and they are predicting that about 5 million people by next spring planting season, about 5 million people will be food insecure. Because what's happening now, the conflict comes on the back of 4 years of pretty severe drought, which caused a good bit of migration from rural to urban areas. Already 2.5 million people are in need of assistance inside the country. It hasn't been because of sanctions. There's pretty stiff sanctions have been imposed on the country, but there's all sorts of carve-outs and exceptions and exemptions to those sanctions to try to avoid some of the worst of what happened in Iraq after the first Gulf War, sort of the civilian consequences of sanctions. That seems to have been largely avoided. There's still a pretty robust trade going on between Turkey and Lebanon and Syria, Turkey and Syria, Iraq and Syria, but yeah, it's going to become a much bigger issue in the short term, within the next 6 months, if this thing isn't resolved and things get back to where they were. Some of these migrants go back to the land and sanctions be lifted and things like that. I think it's going to it could well be looking at if not mass starvation, much worse food insecurity for a much greater number.
I'm going to ask the last question, but both Rami and Mark will be here to ask, we'll stay here for a little bit afterwards so people can talk to you. Critique the U.S. Actions. What have we done right? What have we done wrong?
One of the things about the United States, I think, that we need to keep in mind is that it is passing through and has been for the last probably 6-7 years has been passing through a phase of reduced influence in the Middle East as a whole. The ability of the United States to influence events is less now than it was 5, 10, 20 years ago. The mandate, the legitimacy it has to influence events is much less, and its impact is way down, not just among Arabs, but if you take the four major political groups in the Middle East, Israel, Turkey, Iran, and the Arab world, and the Arab world is very different, but I'll just be Orientalist for a minute and lump them all together. So if you take the Arabs, the Israelis, the Turks, and the Iranians, in all four of these situations, the United States has far less influence than it had before, and in recent years, it has tried with all four of these groups in various ways to push them and prod them and pressure them and cajole them and threaten them to do certain things. And in all four situations, it got pushed back. The Turks, the Arabs, the Israelis, and the Iranians pushed the United States back. They say, look, we don't care about you. We don't respect you. We don't fear you. So the context in which the U.S. finds itself is one of diminished legitimacy and influence capability across the region. It's still the strongest military power in the world, but its capacity to use that military power is vastly diminished now. And Iran and Iraq and Afghanistan are recent examples, which the Russians learned in Afghanistan and the Americans learned in Vietnam before, that you cannot do very much with your military when you send it halfway around the world. So military impact is pretty minimal. Libya was an exceptional case when all NATO got involved. So the U.S., I think, has done the right thing to kind of lay back, not get deeply involved in this, and leave it for the Syrian resistance rebel groups to define what they want to do. The U.S. Is in a peculiar situation where it's trying to sort of cherry pick the opposition groups that it wants to help and others it doesn't want to help. At one level, you can say that's perfectly legitimate. You don't want to give guns to a group that turns out to be Qaeda, which might use them to attack Americans. That's absolutely legitimate. But in a situation like this, it's very difficult to sort out these many, many different kinds of Syrian resistance groups, of which there are a few al-Qaeda. There's a few Islamist militants who are not Qaeda, who are not anti-American, but they're fundamentalist militant Muslims. And you have mainstream Muslim Brotherhood, and then you have the vast majority of the secular nationalist fighters. So the United States has to figure out better than it ever has before how to deal in a situation like that. And the idea that you deal with it by applying the same standards that you apply to situations inside the United States, it doesn't work. You can't just sit there and say, well, I'm going to help this guy, but I don't want to help this guy. Either you're involved in supporting this nationalist liberation struggle, or you're not. If you support this nationalist liberation struggle, and you define it as such, then all of these people are going to be grateful to you, and probably will not turn against you. So I think this is a moment for the United States to think seriously about how does engage in situations around the Arab world or other places in the world where you have such kind of nationalist struggles going on. And the point, the main lesson is that the United States or any foreign power, the French, the Russians, you cannot define your involvement mainly on your national interest. I know that sounds crazy, and the political science professors here will probably tell me I'm nuts, but you define your national interest in terms of access to oil, you want to protect the Israeli state, you want to protect NATO members, you can say that's your nationalist interest, but almost none of those things apply in Syria. Syria is a pure national struggle. Bahrain is different. You can say in Bahrain the United States doesn't do anything with the people fighting the Bahraini government, because it doesn't want to be involved in anything where there's oil produced. And the U.S. clearly says, this is an oil region. The Saudis sent in their army. We support the Saudis. The rebels can go jump in the Gulf. And that's all there is. There's no debate, unfortunately, I think. But that's how it is. In Syria, it's not the case. So the U.S. has to fundamentally decide if it is for these movements of national liberation and getting rid of these security regimes, or if it's not. And the situation is that it's not quite sure. So I think the challenge for the U.S. is to define its own real motives and its own national interests. If it comes out clearly supporting these movements, I think it would be in the best interest of everybody, knowing that the movements themselves, the resistance movements, are the ones taking the lead, and the U.S. simply responds to their requests, whether it's arms or money or diplomatic recognition or whatever.
Mark, do you want to say anything?
Yeah,
one
of these. I think the U.S. so far has done a good job of keeping the government of Israel calm and about this situation. And I think that's no easy task given the material nature of Bibi Netanyahu. But I think, you know, the Israeli government, Syria more than I think any of the other Arab revolts, could really cause problems for Israel, because that of all the borders, that front has been the Golan, has been quietest the longest. So the Assad regime and its national security preoccupations has been to the benefit of Israel. So to keep them quiet and calm about this, at least publicly, I think is a success of the U.S. administration. I think they are wondering how they may have done better in pushing Turkey out into the front and to carry messages and perhaps even carry our water for us. Turkey, as you know, had very close relationships with the Assad regime, particularly the two, Erdogan and Assad personally were very close. Turkey was one of the first and in an accelerated fashion to condemn what the Assad and his regime was doing, got very much out in front in supporting the rebels, and now seems to be a little bit, at least at this time, not quite sure what to do next. And yet I think the U.S. had been hoping that Turkey as a NATO ally, et cetera, would be able to carry a good bit of our diplomatic security interests in Syria, and now Turkey isn't quite sure where it wants to go, doesn't know whose water it wants to carry. So I think we may have misjudged that and recalibrate that.
I'd like to, on behalf of everyone, thank you, Rami.